Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. And we can see that this week we are having a very, very interesting parasha. And this parasha is called Vayelech, which means, and he went. And Moshe went. So, and this is the time that God told Moshe that he has to, you know, it's time for him to come back home, like to come back to his creator. And this Shabbat is a very special Shabbat in the sense that this Shabbat is a Shabbat before Yom Kippur. And so, and we know what is Yom Kippur. Yom Kippurim is known in English as the Day of Atonement, the day that our sins are forgiven by the Holy One of Israel. So on this particular day, we come before Him, making teshuvah, coming before Him. I mean, with all our heart, with all our soul, begging for forgiveness from all our wrongdoing or from all our wrong actions that we might have done during the last year. So, and these days is a very, very important day, and it's the most holiest day in our tradition and in the Jewish history. So, I'm going to match these two events together in this parasha. The Talmud is filled with stories of people who made great achievements in their lives. One of the strange episodes involved a long-life sinner named Eliezer ben Duda. This may not be the place to go into details for the nature and extent of his bad behavior. In one thoughtful moment, he arrested himself even while on the verge of another foul deed. As thought of repentance raged within him as he passed from one world, this is the digest, sanitized version of the story. What am I trying to tell us here? That I said that the Talmud is filled with all kinds of great people who have achieved a lot of things in their life, I mean, who have done great things, who are great rabbis, who are great teachers, you know, who have, you know, given us expand upon the Torah to give us a deeper understanding and the meaning of the Torah. And it also involved all kinds of examples of how to live a holy and a perfect life before the Lord our God. And there is a particular story of this rabbi that is called Rabbi Eliezer ben Duda. This man, according to the Talmud, this man was a full sinner. He committed all kinds of atrocities, all kinds of sin. But they said there was a time that he was on his way to go and commit another sin. Then the Holy One, blessed be He, arrested his soul, I mean his mind. And he began to think within himself, what am I doing? This thing am I doing, is it right or wrong? The Holy One of Israel began to speak unto him in his mind. The Talmud informed us that he was welcomed to the next world and greeted as Rabbi Eliezer ben Duda. When Rabbi, the author of all the Mishneh, heard this heavenly pronunciation, he sighed and responded that some people work an entire lifetime to marry the next world, and some people acquire it in a single moment. What I'm trying to tell us here, I'm trying to explain that this man, after passing from this world to the next world, he was greeted in the heavenly ring as rabbi. People were surprised. They said, what's going on here? This man all his life has been a sinner. And just before he's dead, before being called back home, to where he's actually from, before the presence of the Holy One, he repented. He gave his life to the Holy One. He changed his way. He made a teshuvah before the Holy One, returning back home. And he was greeted in the heavenly realm as a rabbi. And the people and other rabbis that heard about this story said, no, this can be. Because there are rabbis who have walked all their life following all the commandments, doing all the mitzvot, all their life to be able to inherit the world to come, to be able to achieve the world to come. But this man was given to him. It shows you that as it was written that sometimes some people are predestined. That is predestination. You are predestined to achieve greatness. No matter how hard it is, no matter how you walk left and right, to and fro, because you have been predestined to greatness, that greatness will surely come to pass. Rabbi Drew in Yerushalayim asks how Eliezer Ben Yehuda will end the title of a rabbi. Maybe he repented and was forgiven, but he spent a lifetime following his passion. He did not learn repentance does not provide solid Torah knowledge and wisdom. In which way was he now being called a rabbi? The answer is given by a very simple explanation. He is a rabbi of Teshuvah. This man, after passing over to the supernatural world, because he made a Teshuvah, because he gave up himself, saying that all my wrongdoing, all my wrong action, I am putting them aside, and now I want to become a new person. I want to be, as Yeshua placed it, to be born again. You are born, but a man has to do what? Has to be born himself. A woman has to be born herself. Your mama, your papa gave you the natural birth, but you have to reborn yourself in the spirit. This man gave himself a rebirth. He made a teshuvah before the Holy One, saying, I am sorry for all my wrongdoing. I mean, a teshuvah that he really made, not the one that the Christians are saying, that you know what, Jesus has forgiven you your sin, and that is it, then you can continue to do whatever you want to do. Because there is a consequence for every sin. It is not one time and it is done. No. It is brother. It's a lifestyle. It is brotherly every time. When you know that you need something that is strong, you return back home. You need to return back to the Holy One of Israel, asking him for forgiveness. Say, Abba Father, I have done something that is wrong. I am sorry. Please forgive me. I'm making a teshuvah. I want you to trust me, to draw you close to yourself. If God did not draw you close to himself, you cannot draw close unto God. It is God that called us. It is God that gives us the opportunity. It is God that draws us unto himself. And that is making it teshuvah. Repentance, as they translate it as a repentance, or as asking God for forgiveness for all your wrongdoing. The name of this parasha reading is taken from the first word of the parasha itself, Vayelech. This word signified movement, the action of going somewhere. The subject of this verb is a great teacher, Moshe, our leader, Moses. According to Jewish tradition and the word of the great commentator to the Torah, this parasha was recorded for us by Moshe on the last day of his presence on earth. It is truly wondrous that on his last day on earth, Moshe should be described as being in motion, going in strength and fortitude to further teach and guide his beloved people, Israel. Perhaps in this world, Bayelet alone would discover the secret of the greatness and the manifold achievement of Moshe during his lifetime. In this world, Bayelet and the world, he said that even though on his last day on earth, some people say, you know what, oh, this is the last day. They get what? They get rejected, you know? They get, you know, that, oh, okay, everything's coming to an end, la 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 la. But in Moshe, it wasn't so. Moshe was in emotion. He was in the spirit, filled, and the Torah said that even though he was 120 years old, but his energy was never diminished. His strength was never diminished. He was like a young man of 40 years old. He was ready to accomplish even though greatness, even though knowing that in the next second, in the next 2 minutes, he's going to meet God face to face. I mean, this time, on the final time, that he's living, and as a father, you know, to his beloved people, to his beloved children, because these are the children that he has raised up by the power of the Holy One. So, to him, it is very important to impart in them more understanding and more knowledge of the Holy One. Because to him, he loved them so much, to even know more than himself. When Israel sinned, he said, God, if you are not going to forgive them, blot out my name from the book of life which you have written. It shows you the self-sacrifice that Moshe was ready to undergo for God himself to forgive his people. The same self-sacrifice Yeshua made by giving himself up for us. On Yom Kippur, we come to seek God's forgiveness of all our wrong actions, of all our wrongdoings, begging him that he should please, for the sake of his love, for the sake of his for the sake of his word that he has given to our forefathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to please have mercy upon us. This is a special moment, and this is a special time, that as the day of Yom Kippur draw near, these 10 days that from Rosh Hashanah to Yom Kippur, we examine ourselves. Begin to examine our actions, our thoughts, our doings, our business dealing. Have we been robbing people? Have we been lying? Have we been doing one thing or the other that is wrong? We have to begin to search ourselves. We have to start making what's called introspection about ourselves, our inner being. What have we been doing that it is actually contrary to the Torah? What have we been doing that is drawing us away from the presence of the Holy One? What action have we been doing that is taking us away from the glory of the Holy One? So this is the time and this is the day that we begin to introspect ourselves. One on each daily basis, asking God for forgiveness, asking him to please put his light in that area of my life that I might not see. Because as David said, it's not every part of the area of our life that we can see ourselves. If God did not put his touch by his spirit to touch us, so that we will see that this action or this thing that we are doing is actually wrong. Because some people might think that, okay, what I'm doing is right. To them, in their faith, it's right. To them, as far as they feel comfortable, they don't care. But God, by the Spirit of the Holy One, God will turn and say, you know what? Where your right ends, that is where the right of another person starts. You don't just override another person's right because you have the power or because you have the strength to do so. Or because you are higher than him or because you are richer than him, then you can oppress him. Is there any way that we've oppressed the poor? Is there any way that we've not shown love? Is there any way that we've not shown gratitude? Is there any way that we've not, show to the people the light of God that's in us? Book of Isaiah, the children of the Most High God, and people in the world should be able to see this light. But in one way or the other, that we have hidden that light this is the time that we begin through our actions. Though today is the time for us to begin to introspect ourselves in our mind, in our soul, in our spirit, asking Him for forgiveness before Yom Kippur. Normally, people say that, you know what, on Yom Kippur, you cannot ask for forgiveness. Yes, that according to the tradition, because the tradition says that once you enter into the synagogue, then you cannot be asking for forgiveness again. And that is when Yeshua, that is why Yeshua said that if you are coming before the king, right? You are coming before the Holy One of Israel, that, and you remember that you somebody has wronged you, or you have wronged somebody, you should do what? Leave your gift at the door. Go make the restitution. Go and seek for forgiveness. Seek Teshuvah. Then you can now come and do what? And give your gift. And the king will accept it. Why? Because if you do not go and make the restitution to the person that you have wronged, to the people that you stole it from, or from the people that you've oppressed, God said if those people cry unto Him, He's going to listen unto them and He's going to deal with you. So, in no form or in no way should we overlook this. It is extremely important that our children, our wives, our husbands, our fellows, our neighbors, those our co-workers that we might have wronged in one through our work, through our actions, we should start thinking about them and start telling them personally, not just think as a God, you know, forgive me, you know, I did something that is wrong, I know I did this one to my co-workers, to my fellow person, please forgive me, la 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 la, but you have to go personally now to that person and seek forgiveness. You have to tell that person, I know I did you in one way or the other, I have wronged you, please forgive me. Not just only unto God alone, but you have to go to that person to seek forgiveness, restitution of that thing that you think you might have done wrong. Then you can now come back to God and God will forgive you. The Torah record for us that at the end of his life, his physical strength and faculty were in no way diminished. That is the physical faculty of Moshe. That certainly was an exceptional and most unique blessing. But that was a gift from God, as health and longevity always are. The continuing activity on behalf of Torah and the Jewish people was a gift from Moshe to Moshe. It was entirely dependent upon the attitude, commitment, and vision for himself, as is truly described in this week parasha reading as being a person who is on the move, constantly going toward greater heights and more meaningful accomplishments. Moshe was a man that the accomplishment of today is today. We want to accomplish a greater thing tomorrow. He's never satisfied to where he was today. He always wants to increase and to be more, even better than yesterday. And that is the attitude that the Holy One is asking from each and every one of us. We shouldn't just sit down and say, you know what, I'm good. No, it's never good. You should try to do what to improve and improve and improve more in your life, in your personal life, in your family life, in your relationship with others, in your relationship with God, in your relationship with your neighbor, in your relationship with everyone in your country and with everyone that is surrounding you. We should always try to do what to improve and become a better person every day. So we can see this from Moshe, that Moshe himself taught us this example, that it is not just finished until it is finished. You know that we, as Israelites, we as the children of God, we as the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, should always see the greater height. It should always be that light upon the mountain, where that the whole world will come to see and behold and know this man is a special man. This woman, she's a special person. This group of people are God-loving people. Through our actions, through our doing, through our interaction, through the word that comes out of our mouth, people should be able to see the difference. So knowing that these people, they are different people. They are not like the rest of us. Because as the Torah said, that Israel is a solitary nation. It's not it's a special people. It's the only nation. They are going to dwell on their own. They cannot be compared with. And that is what God is seeking for each and every one of us. That we should try to strive for the better. This is also one of the messages that Shabbat Shuvah teaches us. In order to return to God and to begin anew in our quest for holiness and sanctity, we must be proactive in our behavior and attitude. Being passive or apathetic certainly will not accomplish the goal of national and personal return to greatness and holiness. So he's saying now that in order for us to return to God and to begin anew, we must have this quest for a greater height, for holiness. That, you know what, I achieved this today, tomorrow I want to achieve more. I have done this today, tomorrow I want to do better. You know, that is what he is saying, that we have to be able, we shouldn't be, we shouldn't be passive in our actions, in our doing. We should always be proactive. You know, you don't be negative, but always in a positive brain. Don't say, you know what, it seems as if it didn't work out today, and you come, you know, rejected. If it didn't work out today as you planned, tomorrow is tomorrow. Tomorrow is going to be better. So we shouldn't just close our mind and fold our arms and say, you know what, I give up. For the Israeli, for a Jew, we never give up. We continue. We press harder, and we press harder until we get that which we want. And this is not just a thing like that. It is always in our DNA from the beginning. Because we can see that our forefathers, Jacob, never gave up. He fought with the angel. The angel broke his hip. He said, no, I will not give up until what? Until you bless me. I will not let you go. So it is part of us, it is part of our nature, never to give up, but to get unto the end until we receive that blessing. And that blessing is the word that will come. We shouldn't say, you know, because of one thing or the other, because of the physical world, or because of the some hardship, or because of some problem in our life, then you know what, I give up this way. I am tired, you know, I cannot longer do it again. No. God is teaching us a principle. And that principle is for us not to give up, to continue in this way. But the way, yes, the way is tough. The way is a narrow road, as Yeshua describes it. He said, it's a narrow road and few people are found in there. But there is another road that is wide and big. And in this road, majority, 99%, are found. I want to give an example from which one of our members, Hassan, gave to me, Anatoly. He said that there are two groups of people in the world. And these two groups of people, one is meant to be a slave forever, and the other is meant to rule. There is a group of people, 99.8% are what we call the golden buyers. They only purchase, they only buy and buy. But 0.2% are what is called, they are entrepreneurs. They do. They are doers. They bring things into life. They bring things into being. Right? And the other 99 percent are always like a slave unto them, but they only buy from them. But what they were making those people richer and richer and richer. You see, so God is telling us in this way too, that we should be among those 0.2% that with our life, with our being, we should be a doer. We should be some people that can lead others into doing the right things. That people looking at our life, seeing what we are doing, they can follow us and do the same. That is very, very important for a child of God. Life is precious and fleeting and should be exploited to the fullest. Being in motion physically and spiritually is really the secret of success, longevity, and lifetime achievement. Even the great Moshe is not granted physical immortality, nor will he even be granted all of the wishes he had for himself on this earth. Yet, until his very last breath, Moshe devotes himself to accomplishing his goal and to leading the Jewish people, the Israelites, into the promised land. This short parasha, which should serve us as an inspiration to us all, that continuity, that when we continue to do that which is right, we will surely get there. The answer will surely come. It might look a little bit difficult from the beginning, but as we continue, like I'll give an example. Like if you want to build a team, you might make some mistakes, right, in the beginning. You know, some little mistakes. But as you begin to practice more and practice make perfect. I begin to practice, you are going to get there, and at the end, you are going to say, wow, I have achieved, I have arrived. So that is what from the mistake you learn. You don't let your mistake make you passive. You don't say, okay, I have made it, oh, that is the end. No, from your mistake, it should make you to be wiser, to be smarter. Right, so that I know that I did this mistake. Okay, next time I will do it. So I go. Okay, I know how to bypass it. So that is what the parasha actually is telling us, that we should always be in motion. We should always be a doer. We should not sit down and pull our hand and be a type of people or be a type of person that only purchase and buy and buy and buy and buy, but in their mind they cannot even create anything in their mind. God wants us to be a person that can create, to be like our Father who is our creator. So we should always be in motion. We should always aim for the best, for more higher and higher and higher and higher responsibility. This parasha is a very short one, and it's leading us into the day of atonement. It's leading us into the days of repentance, where the door of heaven, the windows of heaven, is open for forgiveness. That we should seek Him, the Holy One, and begging Him for all our wrongdoing. I cannot overemphasize how important this is. On Yom Kippur, we come to the synagogue all day. We stay in the synagogue all day. Morning service, afternoon service, and evening service, all performed. We have to afflict ourselves. The Torah said, afflict yourself. Our rabbi told us that we have to fast. We have to discipline the physical flesh. We have to say that you flesh has no power over my soul. We have to exalt our spirit. That our spirit should take control of our being, not the flesh. Right? Most of the time, we see people who spend hundreds of thousands of dollars taking care of our physical flesh. It is good. I'm not saying it's wrong, it is good. But one thing I want us to remember, that this physical flesh at the end of days is going to be a manure. It's going to go back to where it comes from. But what about your soul? What abuse How much have you spent? What time have you spent to make the restitution, to come back to your holy one, to make your soul the higher soul, to make your soul what God has made it to be from the beginning, an intelligent soul? So that is what God is talking here about, that we as children, we as a Jew should always seek Him in a greater height. He told us that if you would not listen, if you would disobey, that is two things that God is presenting, life and death. The Torah is two halves of the same coin. So we have to make a choice. On Yom Kippur, we make a choice. We make a choice unto life. We make a choice that our name is sealed in the book of life. As in Rosh Hashanah, we said, may your name be written in the book of life. On Yom Kippur, we said, may your name be sealed in the book of life. Your name be written doesn't mean that it is sealed. If you do something wrong, it can be removed. As Moses said, God, if you put my name, remove it. If you are not going to forgive them, so it is possible for your name to be removed, even though your name is written, but it can be removed through your action, through what you are doing. But when your name is sealed, it can never be removed. Sealed by the power of the Holy One, because you follow Him in spirit and in truth. He said, if Joshua will lead them into the promised land, do not be discouraged. Do not be afraid of them, because it is not you that is going to do what? To fight for yourself. But I, the Most High, will fight for you. Don't be afraid of them, because the Lord your God is the one who is going to do it. It is our God, the God of our forefathers, that is going to do it by His strength. So, but we have to do our own work. And our work is what? Our work is to follow Him as He has commanded us, to follow the mitzvah that He has given us. That we should do that which is right. Justice, you shall pursue. We want us to do justice in the land. Because our land, the land of Israel, is a demanding one. So, this is what the parasha is all about today. Continued motion, working for a greater good, for a better life, for every person, for your family, for your wife, for your children, for your husband, for your community, for your nation, for your state. It started from somewhere. God called Abraham from among the people. Went up from Abraham. God took his son, Isaac. Abraham has a lot of sons. God took Isaac. From Isaac, God took Jacob. From Jacob, has a lot of people, a lot of children. God said, okay, I need another person that I'm going to draw closer unto myself. God took Levi. Make them the Kohanim to be a blessing to the entire nation. From Levi, God took the family, Moshe. Okay? That's how it goes. One by one, God expands. It's the same principle, it's the same theory. God just expands and expands and expands on it. So God is asking us today to search ourselves, to search our being. Where have we done wrong during last year? Who have we done something that is not right? That we should seek Teshuvah. We should come back home because the Day of Atonement is near. As it is said on Yom Kippur, Gamar Hatima Tova, may your name be sealed in the book of life. So may our names be sealed in the book of life. Parashat Vayelech. Shabbat Shalom.